remember in the early days in the 70s when I started out, things were so different that people you were interviewing would actually lay their drugs out in front of you and snort while you were interviewing them. And they would never offer me.
Proud mother. That's unkind. Things have changed a lot, I guess, for you over a few years.
Oh, yeah.
So how long were you at Newsweek before you...
I was at Newsweek for 31 years.
Good Lord.
A long time.
Yes.
And then I continued to write for them after I took a buyout. Mm-hmm. I had a contract the next year. And I'm still writing for them as a freelancer, even though it's a whole new magazine now.
So does it... I mean, 31 years as a film critic, or 30 more than 31 years as a film critic.
Yeah, more than that, because I was a critic up at the Real Paper in Boston for a couple of years before I went to Newsweek.
Completely different universe from the perspective of being a film critic?
Not completely, no. Part of what I do, you know, draws on the same things that I would bring as a critic, you know, mm-hmm. because I'm looking at movies, but I'm looking at movies in a slightly different way now because I'm a programmer. So mm-hmm. It's not the same thing because you're thinking about the overall picture of the festival, you're mm-hmm. thinking about the balance, you're thinking about your audience. I mean, I love all the movies that we're showing, but some I love more than others, you
right.
know, and some it isn't the same. And it's much more of a team sport. Working on a festival, you know, being a critic is a very solitary thing. You're sitting behind your computer.
But was it more solitary? I mean, when you started in the early years, was it more solitary? Because now with the internet and everything, it seems like the new thing is group think, you know, and who's the Rotten Tomatoes score and all that stuff.
Well, yeah, that's true. There was no Rotten Tomatoes when I started out. Oh, the tomatoes were very fresh in those days. Yeah, I mean, film criticism has changed enormously, and its role in the world has changed enormously. And there's so many more. Everybody's a film critic now with the internet. And so many film critics have lost their jobs. You know,
it's not many actual jobs left as a film, as a full-time film critic.
Very few.
A mixed job.
Yeah.
I think it's under 90 now.
Is it under 90?
Yeah.
Really?
That are full-time. I mean, there are people who do
right,
a little bit,
right.
but...
Yeah. And it's sad because there's no, you know, local criticism is disappearing,
mm-hmm.
you know, because the newspapers want to save money, and so they pick up the syndicated stuff, and it's given certain people a lot of power because their reach is much broader.
It's amazing how few critics the Chicago Tribune group has, the Tribune company.
Mm-hmm.
They have 12 papers, and I think it's now down to 4 critics
wow.
covering the entire country. So it's a little
yeah.
unusual.
Yeah. No, it's like critics were the first to go. They got the axe, you know, when they started cutting costs.
So is a film festival a safe place to go in that regard? Does it give you a chance to ply your trade and, you know, bring things to people in a more direct way?
Yeah. I mean, there's a kind of satisfaction that you can get bringing a movie when you're actually there and you see people responding to the movie that you found, you
mm-hmm.
know, that's very satisfying. It's a kind of it's direct in a way that being a critic is not, even though you know you put out the word and you may hear that, oh, somebody thanks you for recommending a movie, but this
right.
is, you know, to hear an audience go crazy for a movie that you love, you know, it's a very satisfying experience. And to see the filmmakers there, and you know, it's one of the things that's very cool about the LA Film Festival, and I take no credit for this because it was in existence before I was there. It's the only festival that does this filmmaker retreat mm-hmm. before the festival starts. I mean, most film festivals, the filmmakers come in from all over the world. They don't know anybody. They're in a strange city.
Mm-hmm.
They do their thing and they leave and they never really interact. We bring all our feature filmmakers, all those who can come,
mm-hmm.
together just before the festival starts. We do it up at Skywalker Ranch, which is an idyllic setting. And we basically, you know, introduce them all to each other. We bring in people from the industry for them to mingle mm-hmm. with. William Friedkin will be there because he's our guest director this year. We wine them and dine them, and they feel like they've died and gone to heaven, and they all bond. So
mm-hmm.
they have a completely different experience of the festival. And it's really fun for them, you know, and they go see each other's movies, and it develops a nice spirit, you know, and it's something that's, I don't know why other festivals don't do it.
Probably money, I would think, would be the primary thing.
Yeah, we can barely do it ourselves. but we're determined not to lose this because it's very special.
Yeah.
You know? And, well, and there, you know, and we get so many sort of grateful letters from filmmakers who've just had the best time.
What is the experience? I mean, you talk to filmmakers who go to festivals, and they, mm-hmm. the bigger festivals, like LAFF, yeah. they generally don't get to see movies. They don't get to meet, right. you know, it really is kind of an isolating, weird,
yeah,
it can surprisingly be. Disconnected experience for
it
people.
It can be. But, you know, a lot of people who come to the LA Film Festival, they stick around when they can
yeah.
and see as much as they can. And the people in the competition who are usually young and beginning filmmakers, you know, these are all our competition films are premieres mm-hmm. and they're movies that don't have distributors. And, you know, they go and see each other's movies, you know, and they don't really, it doesn't feel competitive, you know, it feels kind of collegial.
So how difficult is that in these days? I mean, you have a lot of film festivals in the world, obviously.
Yeah.
A huge amount of competition from, you know, big funded film festivals
right.
that are like LAFF or bigger. Mm-hmm. festival like Tribeca is, you know, has a lot
yeah,
of cash.
They may
not,
money.
They're
yeah.
not as influential as LAFF, I don't think, but they are,
yeah.
they have certainly enough money to do what they want to do a
right.
lot of times.
Right.
Is it getting harder? I mean, this is your third year doing it.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, because, you know, until the economy recovers, it's going to be very tough. I mean, Film Independent, which is the, you know, mother organization of the festival, is a nonprofit.
Mm-hmm.
So we're very much dependent on corporate sponsorship, and corporate sponsorship in this day and age is, yeah. is hard to come by. But somehow we found it, you know, and we survived.
But is it hard to actually find films that you go, okay, this is a great competition film that nobody's ever shown before, it's not the hasn't found its place yet, or
no? Well, I don't know. I'm pretty happy about what we found this year. But you always go in worried about just that. You know, mm. well, is it going to be? Because you're, you know, you can't make the movies. You're dependent on what's out there, and there are good years and there are bad years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I can even remember back in the days when I was on the selection committee for the New York Film Festival, which you would think, you know, could get anything. Mm-hmm. There were some bad years, you know, where it was hard to fill up all the slots, and mm-hmm. there were years where you had too much. I think we've got a strong competition lineup. What we do, it's a mixture of world premieres,
mm-hmm.
and one of the things that I kind of changed when I came in is that I made the narrative competition international. It was much more focused just on American independence
mm-hmm.
In the past. And now it's roughly 50-50, and I think that's really raised the level.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also allowed us to pick up films, you know, some of the films there were movies I saw in Berlin. They're U.S. or North American premieres.
Right.
Most of the American indies are world premieres. I think all of them are.
And I think
the same
that's
is
actually
true of the documentaries.
The indie business has changed. I mean, I think that it's. I mean, it's one of my complaints about Sundance, or not Sundance. Mm-hmm. Actually, ironically, one of my complaints about the Independent Spirit Awards is I feel like it should be the American Independent Spirit
mm-hmm.
Awards, because the emphasis is on American independence.
Right.
Whereas the independent movement really is now an international phenomenon. We have
oh, absolutely.
The international movies are as important, or more so at times, than the American stuff.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, it's all the funding is international. It's
yeah.
getting harder and harder to sort of identify what country a movie is from.
So you don't have to worry about identifying it for your purposes.
No. That's not a problem for us.
And so it's still first-time filmmakers when you go overseas?
Not first-time filmmakers.
Okay.
But they can be, but not really established filmmakers. I mean, you're not gonna show a Jacques Audiard movie in
right.
a competition, you know, because he's been around. But
Harvey might pay you to do that.
but they're usually first or second or sometimes even third-time filmmakers.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, they're not big, big names.
So of the kind
we've got recognizable names mm-hmm. in our competition.
Film? You mean directing names or?
Alex Karpovsky, for example, who
mm-hmm.
certainly people who know the Mumblecore movies,
right.
and he's as an actor, he's been in many movies.
Mm-hmm.
He stars in and directs a very funny movie called Red Flag, which we have the world premiere of. So he's, you know, he's not a first-time filmmaker. I think
right.
this is maybe his third feature.
But it feels and right.
It feels right. You know, it's very, you know, it's low budget.
Mm-hmm.
It's, he's playing, it's very close to the bone. He's playing a character named Alex Karpovsky, who's a filmmaker. But it's very clearly a fiction. But, I mean, he really shows his comic chops in this one. You know, it's tight. It's a revelation.
So is it more of that than less these days, where you're dealing with a lot of people who are more DIY movement you know, kind of coming of age in that era?
There's some very DIY movies in our
DIY,
in our competition.
Doing it backwards, yeah.
do it yourself. Laura Coella's movie, Breakfast with Curtis. You know, this is a movie that she shot in her own house using her own, like, roommates and neighbors. But it's a very special kind of, it doesn't feel like an American indie you would see at Sundance. You know, it's got its own character, and it's one of the rare American indies that's kind of devoted to the pleasure principle. You know, it's a little gem that that we discovered kind of out of nowhere, and which is what makes this job fun. When suddenly something comes in, you don't solicit it, you don't know anything about it, and you say, "Ooh, you know, here's something special."
So, do you feel competitive with Sundance or with?
No, not with Sundance particularly. We actually show a fair number of Sundance movies. You know, what we consider the best of Sundance. We're showing Beasts of the Southern Wild as one of our galas, and it's, you know, I think it's an amazing movie.
And coming out
and
a few weeks after,
very
no?
happy to show it.
Yeah.
We're more competitive with Tribeca, actually. You know? We try to encourage filmmakers to come to us and not to Tribeca.
And does San Francisco fit into this at all, or is it kind of like a weird?
So much, you know. We don't really feel that competitive with San Francisco.
It's kind of fascinating cluster because you have Tribeca and San Francisco really on top of each other,
right?
You have Seattle in the middle, kind of. You have South by a little before,
right?
And you guys, and it's all kind of. You're all kind of in the same realm of, you know, significance or weight or whatever, different different kind of skill sets.
But it's kind of amazing how different our programs are and how many movies there are out there, you know. I mean, Tribeca showed a lot of movies we rejected this year.
And do you go to South by and
I don't go to
stuff,
I don't I go to Sundance.
Right.
I go to Berlin. Those are the main ones for me. I mean, I've been to, you know, I went to Gothenburg a couple of years ago, in Sweden, where there's a huge Scandinavian film market, and I saw some, you know, interesting stuff there. But we have different people going to different festivals. We have people in South by, we have people going to Doug Jones' associate programmer goes to Busan in Korea, and goes to ICFA in Amsterdam to see the documentaries. We've got somebody in San Sebastian, so we cover the waterfront.
So it's a tough gig, is what you're saying.
Well, it is a tough gig. I don't want to, you know. I'm not complaining, but what's interesting is how many. I'm seeing many more movies than I ever saw as a critic. You know, many more.
Is it hard to keep them all together? I mean, as a critic, you probably saw 300 or so movies a year, 250 to 300, I guess.
Now I'm seeing that much just in the first 4 months of the year.
So does it get to be blurry after a while? Do you have to kind of like stop and go, wow, that seemed really good, but I'm not so sure?
You know, it gets blurry when the movies are bad. And they kind of go in and out of your head really fast. But the good ones imprint themselves. And you do, you know, there are those moments when you say, oh my God, am I losing? You know, can I tell what's a good movie or not? And then all of a sudden, a movie will come along that you just kind of say, ah, that's a good movie, you know. It's just, you know, no doubt about it.
It does wake you up, doesn't it?
It totally wakes you up, and it reminds you why you're doing what you're doing, you know.
So when you go to festivals, do you sit through every feature all the way, or do you actually get up and leave now?
No, at festivals, you know, it's something I couldn't do as a critic.
Right.
I had to sit through every damn movie I had.
And every minute of it.
And that could be painful. At festivals, no, I have the luxury. If it's very clearly... Right. Not for us. Why waste the time?
Is it strange? Do you feel like you're itchy trigger finger every time you're going to get up and walk out of something?
It is a little strange at first. You have that sort of guilt feeling that, you know. It's just more efficient that way. But I was surprised, actually, this year how few movies I walked out of in Berlin. Very few.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Were they just better, or were you being more patient?
Either they were better, or I was making better decisions about which ones to go see. There weren't that many that I walked out of.
Do you think we've turned a corner a little bit? I mean, it felt like for a while we were kind of floating in this everything's trying to be a Sundance movie that sells for a lot of money moment. In the indie moment, and now it seems like the kids, I guess, the kids in their mumblecore have somehow dragged us back to something a little bit more real.
And more indie.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think people have lowered their expectations, you know, in terms of, you're not going to make, you know, the rare movie is going to get picked up for millions of dollars at Sundance these days.
So were you always okay with lower style filmmaking? I mean, I'm sure Cassavetes was okay by you, but as the mumblecore era came and the you know, the DIY stuff came, were you when you were just a film critic,
right?
I mean, that was your was that a little off-putting, or were you always kind of like, let's go with a swim?
I guess there was a sort of a period of adjustment, I would say. I didn't instantly cotton to the mumblecore, and you know, I mean, mumblecore, I'm not comfortable with that.
Well, it's no longer relevant. It's kind of like...
It really isn't relevant, you know.
It's Joe Swinburg is, I think, the last one left, really. It's kind of like Dogma.
Right. It's like it stopped. Exactly. You know, these labels don't mean very much anymore.
Yeah.
You know, certainly mumblecore doesn't mean much.
Well, I felt like the Duplasses made their first French film this year in Jeff Who Lives at Home. And it was like such a level above the kind of film. And it wasn't that the content was similar, but the... Yeah. The intent and the focus of the filmmaking seemed to be just on a different level than they had been working previously. Like they've graduated.
Really? I felt that happen with Cyrus.
Well, Cyrus,
because I thought Cyrus actually was at a level higher than Jeff myself.
Okay.
Personally.
Well, but I mean, it's an interesting thing to watch them graduate.
Yeah.
It's like this, you know, they get their cap and gown. And,
yeah. You know, and you'll have that feeling when you see the Alex Garpovsky movie, you know, which I wouldn't call mumblecore, you know. It's kind of too well written and well structured and tight, you know. I mean, it's a very, you know, efficient comedy, but very, very personal at the same time.
So are you part of the party of LAFF? It does seem like part of it is this is truly a festival as opposed to just going to see a bunch of films.
It is a festival, and there is a kind of a party feel, which I like, you know. I mean, I have a ball during the festival. It's totally exhausting, you know. I'm going, you know, 24/7 and getting to bed at 3 in the morning, but it's very exhilarating, you know, as long as everything goes well, you know. There aren't any technical snafus, which
so are you sitting there kind of smooth. Sweating that as you go through each of the days?
Well, you know, I mean, you always have to worry about this, you know, there's a million things to worry about, but I'm pretty confident because the team, the production team is really good.
Yeah.
And things have run very smoothly the last, my 2 years there.
Has it changed at all over the 3 years for you?
Well, sure. I mean, the first year I didn't really know what I was getting into. You know, it was all brand new, and I was kind of learning as I was going. And now I'm feeling a little more... I think I was more nervous the second year because I knew what I was getting into.
And now you're the relaxed veteran?
Now a little more relaxed, but we'll see. You know, you never know.
Can you imagine doing this work for as the rest of your career? I mean, does it sound feel like something...
Well, I don't... you know, I'm as long as I'm enjoying it, you know, and I am enjoying it. I really like it. I'll keep doing it, you know.
Do you have an off season? Do you feel like
I do have an off season? Is that the question?
Yeah.
An off season? Yeah. Actually, I get a few months off, and that's when I do. You know, I do some journalism, particularly at the end of the year when the movies get more interesting. I've been doing Newsweek stuff. But it really starts up, I mean, officially I'm off from sort of the second week in July until the first week in December. But in fact, the job starts up in September when I go to Toronto.
Right.
And I try to go usually to the New York Film Festival, and you know, it never completely stops.
They just
stop paying me.
So do you feel the role of a festival these days is to serve Los Angeles, the Los Angeles Film Festival, or to serve greater film kind as we know it, or some combination?
Well, it's a combination, but we definitely are trying to mold a festival for Los Angeles. And we're very conscious of this incredibly diverse city, you know, and I think we've assembled an incredibly diverse festival, you know. And, you know, having worked for the New York Film Festival for 8 years. I mean, that's a completely different kind of festival. You know, they only show about 22 movies, and it's sort of, you know what they're going to be. You know, they're the high tourists, you know, the cream of the can crop. And very little genre stuff, you know. We're really, I mean, and this is reflective of my taste as a critic. you know, let's celebrate every different kind of cinema as long as it's good cinema, you mm-hmm. know. I mean, we have a section called The Beyond that is, you know, horror and, you know, more, you know, off the wall stuff. It's sort of more the equivalent of what other people would call midnight movies, or we don't show them at midnight.
Would you fall in love with, or you hand off to a 22-year-old who likes
well,
that kind of thing?
Doug Jones is the aficionado.
He's not 22.
He's not 22, but that's more his turf. Although one of the choices was mine this year, Juan of the Dead, the Cuban zombie movie, mm-hmm. which I had the good fortune of actually watching them film some of it in Havana a couple of years ago. Hmm. But Doug is sort of the curator of the Beyond section for the most part.
But if your taste swung, I mean, it's always interesting to me. Manola loves, for instance, Manola Dargis of the New York Times loves, like, you know, Joel Silver movies.
Right.
She has this like little weakness for them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have that also?
I wouldn't say there's, you know, it's as specific as saying I love Joel Silver movies. But but yeah,
I'm not sure she loves all Joel Silver movies.
No, I'm sure she doesn't. But yeah, I mean, I've always been open to all kinds of genres and big Hollywood movies if they're good ones, you mm-hmm. know. I mean, and we're showing some studio movies this year, you know. I mean, the Soderbergh Magic Mike is wonderful, you know, and I think it's one of Soderbergh's best in a long time.
So it doesn't feel like you're having Transformers again. This feels like
a
movie that's actually worth showing and happens to be at Warner Brothers.
Absolutely. I mean, it was a movie that I had my eyes on since last September and very grateful that it all kind of worked out and the timing worked out.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the kind of Hollywood movie I think we should be showing.
Are you guys still doing any of that? Because I remember we had the conversation years ago, not you and I, but I had the conversation with the LAFF family about, you know, Transformers opening the festival, I think, two times.
Yeah.
Are you guys doing any of that this year? Or is it kind of movies like Magic Mike, which are really kind of missed?
Well, we're showing, you know, we have the premiere of Pixar's Brave. Which is nothing like the Transformers.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, who wouldn't be happy to show a Pixar movie?
Yeah.
You know, we've got the North American premiere of the Woody Allen movie as our opening night, and Woody is coming.
Oh, that's exciting.
It's very exciting.
Woody in L.A.
You know, Woody in L.A. He doesn't come to the Oscars, but he comes to the L.A. Film Festival, and he's going to bring a lot of his cast.
Mm-hmm.
Alec Baldwin, Penelope Cruz will be there, and others. So I think, you know, I think we've got our sort of tentpole movies this year, I think, are, you know, as good a crop as the LA Film Festival has ever had.
Yeah.
And
Woody Allen and Pixar
and
are not pandering. And Soderbergh.
No. You know. Yeah. Not a Transformer in sight.
Is that something you have an influence in, or is ultimately that an issue of, you know, the size of the organization and trying to draw a crowd and all that kind of stuff?
I mean, let's just say, you know, I draw the line at certain movies, you know,
mm-hmm.
which, sure, they may draw a crowd, but I don't think they're right for the festival.
Yeah. Well, no, they're philosophical. I mean, there's an argument that happens at a lot of big film festivals where there's that thing, okay, they'll come, they came for Transformers and they stayed for, you know,
right,
the rest of the movies.
Right.
But
well, you know, we did, the first year that I did this, we called it Festival Adjacent.
Uh-huh.
But we showed, it's like the biggest movie. We showed the Twilight movie.
Right.
And it was, we made it very clear that this was kind of a special sort of sidebar event. It turned into kind of a fascinating experience because all these people came and camped out in the plaza at LA Live.
Wow.
And what was interesting was that there were people, you know, who came from all over the country, and they did go see some of these other kinds of movies that they would never go to see. And, you know, we got some feedback like, ooh, I've never seen anything like that. That's, you know, I'm really glad I saw that, you know. It's nice when that happens, you know. But, you know, I think that was good for the festival to have that, you know. It certainly got us a lot of publicity.
Yeah.
And many happy, you know, Twilight people.
There is something glorious about that festival where you just go and go see movies and not quite sure what you're going to see, but you just, you know, spin the wheel and buy a ticket because David Ansen programmed it. It's an opportunity. I mean, there are not a lot of festivals where people, you know, that village feel, I guess, that they, you know.
Yeah.
And all 3 years you've been downtown, right?
Yes.
So.
Yeah. My first year was also our first year downtown. And I'm very happy about the move. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it feels more like a festival down there. Mm-hmm. It's more contained. It's more focused. There's a kind of excitement in the air, and we're getting, you know, a downtown. We're getting a different audience.
Yeah.
It's a more diverse audience. It's a somewhat younger audience. Mm-hmm. And people are taking a chance on, you know, I mean, we're showing every, you know, we're showing stuff that's non-narrative and mm-hmm. more experimental, like the wonderful Bestiaire. Have you seen that? You've got to see it.
Huh.
Denis Coté's movie.
Yeah.
Which looks at animals in a way you've never, I mean, the cinematography is unbelievable. It's a movie about observation, and mm-hmm. it's exhilarating, even though it's not narrative. I'd recommend it to anybody.
Any other surprises like that?
Oh, there's a lot. I mean, there's a little gem, I think, in our competition. It's only about an hour long, a Czech movie that I saw the last day I was in Berlin, called A Night Too Young.
Mm-hmm.
I think a really talented young filmmaker just out of film school, but somebody, you know, you're going to be definitely hearing from.
Mm-hmm. And daring for you to show an hour movie. Are you connecting it with something else? Or
we're going to show a short beforehand, but not a real long one.
Right.
But an hour seems long enough to qualify.
Though it's interesting, some film festivals are shy away from that, and they're, you know, the odd lengths and all that kind of stuff.
There are a number of odd lengths. It seems like filmmakers are a little more concise this year.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have that many really long movies. I mean, there have been years when we've shown eight-hour movies. You know? Nothing like that.
Not this year. Okay.
They just weren't out there. But it's amazing how many films there are that are actually under 90 minutes. A lot of documentaries that are clocking in at like 80 minutes or so.
And a great year for docs, or a good year for docs?
I think it's a very good year for docs. There's so much good documentary filmmaking going on out there, and it's interesting how many of them are directed by women. But we've got a couple of really powerful docs in our competition. One called Sunkissed. Mm-hmm. There's one called Call Me Cuchu. There's a documentary in our international section called Without Gorky about the artist Arshil Gorky, the famous abstract expressionist. Mm-hmm. But this is not your standard sort of art doc, because it was made by his granddaughter. And it's about the aftermath of his suicide on his family. Oh. It's like a ghost story almost. And it's amazing. You know, it's really, really good. There's a lot of docs I like this year.
It's funny, the ongoing argument about women filmmakers is kind of, to me, like almost like a gay marriage thing. Like, you know, it's an opportunity for gay people to have divorces and suffer all the things that married people have in the world. It seems like female filmmakers, you know, are complaining because they don't have a chance to direct Transformers. Like, Transformers keeps on coming up, but,
right.
You know, Captain America or whatever.
Yeah.
But do they really want, you know, it's like
in
documentary and in, like, small intimate films, they seem to be... Plenty of female directors these days.
Lots.
Like, you know, you kind of, do they want that opportunity that Hollywood offers, or do they actually want to make films they care about?
It's a good question, you know. I mean, I hope they want to make films they care about.
Yeah. I mean, Catherine Bigelow makes films she cares about, but
absolutely.
She almost always makes films about boys.
Yeah.
She doesn't really make girl films.
No, she's not interested in that.
No.
But she's doing what she wants, you know, and more power to her. She was our guest director 2 years ago and came up to the ranch, which was great.
And does your guest director program any films, or?
Traditionally, the guest director picks a movie that influenced them or that they love. This year, we're doing it a little bit differently because Friedkin is going to show Killer Joe, since it's new and fresh. It's actually one of the only movies that I haven't had a chance to see.
Really? Okay.
In the whole festival.
So when I say you should serve fried chicken afterwards, you don't have any reason to know what I'm talking about.
No, but I have a hunch.
I think actually on Twitter, since Billy Friedkin is now on Twitter, I said, you know, after the movie, I want to take Gina Gershon out for chicken. He's like, good luck with that. So to give everybody a hint as to what's coming up.
Hmm.
So what are you looking forward at this point to... getting on with it and, you know, just getting into it? Is that the...
Yeah, I'm ready to roll.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to be, you've got to sort of take a deep breath and, you know, hope that your energy, you know, that you can survive it.
And you just spend the entire time rooting for films and filmmakers? You feel
like I mean, I do, you know, a lot of what I do down there, I do introductions, mm-hmm. I run Q&A sessions, you know, there's a lot of parties I have to go to, you know. Very, you know.
Yes. Very brave.
Boo-hoo. We've had some great parties during my time there. We had a fabulous party for Leave It on the Floor a couple of years ago. Did you go to that one?
I didn't. I have a very bad track record with LAFF, I have to say.
Really?
I do.
We'll have to correct that.
It's because it's at home. Something about being at home makes it harder to get out somehow.
Yeah, it's a hometown prejudice. I know. I know exactly what you mean.
I'm almost always at opening night, and I often at closing, and then the middle. It's sometimes hit or miss.
Yeah.
Though
I
feel guilty about that.
You should.
I should. Well,
should do better this year.
I should.
Because you're missing a lot of good movies that you'll never have the chance to see, some of them.
Well, it's a funny thing about film festivals because you're not, if you don't know, you know, because you can't, like, you're actually like an audience when you're, even as a film critic, you're like an audience at a festival.
Right.
Then the motivation to get in the car and go, okay, I'm taking off 4 hours and going to, you know, go see that film is not as clear.
Right.
And it kind of sucks because. Yeah. Those are the films that you never see at Sundance. You know, like there's always that those weird new frontier categories and whatever things that you feel like you really should have seen the more Canadian films at Toronto.
Yeah.
You know, you should have tried more things, but it's hard.
Well, you should try. I mean, like our international section this year is really strong. We have an incredible movie from Switzerland called Sister, which won the Silver Bear in Berlin. Mm. Woman director, someone, you know, you should really keep your eye on. It's a really terrific movie. We've got some of the best stuff at Sundance this year was in their international section, and we're showing two, Teddy Bear from Denmark and The Last Elvis from Argentina, which are really good movies.
It's funny how they started that at Sundance, and hasn't quite gotten the traction that I think they hoped.
No, it hasn't. It
deserves it, though.
It does deserve it, because I think, you know, those two movies I just mentioned were better than, you know, 90% of the movies in the in the narrative competition.
Well, when I programmed a festival years ago, I, you know, the experience of international docs coming in from filmmakers I had never really heard of, you know, maybe some peripheral thing where I heard something, but the number of them, the amount of them, the quality, the stories they had to tell were, and so the diversity from what we see in America even.
Right.
Extraordinary, you know, and just never get a chance to be seen over here. It's kind of like, with the internet and everything else, you would hope that will change in time.
Right, but no, I mean, the distribution for foreign films is really is really bad. And L.A., let's face it, has traditionally not been a good town for foreign films, you know.
No.
And there's that whole generational thing, you know. There's a whole generation that we're told doesn't like to watch subtitles.
Yeah.
But I think if they saw some good movies with subtitles, they would change their minds.
Well, it feels a little like it's getting harder because LA's theatrical, their exhibitors situation is kind of getting rougher and rougher. It feels like it's, you know, Westwood shutting down and, you know, even great new theaters like the Landmark are half filled with studio product. And
Right. But, you know, Lemley has opened those new theaters out in the Valley and they're going to expand the Royal into, I think, a 3-screen.
Are they? Okay.
Yeah.
Which things that are good to know.
Good news. The more the merrier.
So you're ready to go. You're in the gate.
Yeah, I'm ready to go. As ready as I'll ever be.